All right, this is Dan Lier. Welcome to the 1% Academy. This is all about success, where we interview the most successful people here in Las Vegas. And I am so thrilled today that we have an iconic entertainer in Las Vegas, a guy that came here with nothing and created a dream, Mr. Jeff Civillico.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Jeff. Thanks for the sound effects.
Yeah. I'm very psyched to be here.
That's great. Thank you for making the time. You're a really, really busy dude. And I got something for you.
Okay.
So when I came to Vegas about 15 years ago, I didn't know anything about Vegas. Mm-hmm. And so there was this guy that they called Mr. Las Vegas, right? What's his name?
Mr. Las Vegas. Wayne Newton.
Yeah, Wayne Newton. So I know Wayne just because of Jennifer, obviously.
Yeah.
Because I had never even heard of Wayne Newton before I came to Vegas. And then, of course, Jennifer's entertainment. So, but you know, he's kind of old school.
Yeah.
I don't mean that in a bad way.
No, he's great.
So, you know, we got to change the guard. So you are now the new Mr. Las Vegas.
Oh, thank you. When you said that, I was thinking of George Wallace, because he's also a great guy.
And I like George.
Yeah, I like George.
I was on a flight with him one day. I like George, but you're the new Mr. Las Vegas. So. We're here with Mr. Las Vegas, Mr. Jeff Civillico.
Very kind, Dan. Very kind. Thank you.
So, Jeff, this show is all about success. As we talk to the 1% Academy, people are looking to improve, scale their business, reach success. And so I want to talk to you about your story. You are an iconic Las Vegas entertainer right now that does more than entertain. And that's why Jeff's here, because not only is he an entertainer, but he's a businessman. Mm. He took his idea. He created action steps, he got his goal, and now he's doing big things, and I want to talk about that.
Awesome, well thanks.
So let's talk about your story.
Yeah, well, you know, it is funny that you say about the business side, because that's often overlooked in entertainment, right? There's show business, and a lot of people joke and say the business word is bigger than the show word, right? So it's almost more important that you have a good business sense, and that's always, I think, been kind of a differentiator for me. I think it's a combination of family growing up and schooling, but I always thought about what I did as a product. Mm-hmm. Say, like, I have a product. The product just happens to be a comedy show. It happens to be a clean comedy show where really I'm the widget. I am the widget. And how do I market that widget to various different markets? You know, how does that resonate with different groups, and how can I monetize that brand?
Right.
And so I just spoke to the UNLV Executive MBA class about branding.
Yeah.
And it was an honor to be asked. There were three branding speakers. One was on the Vegas Golden Knights, one was on the LVCVA, and I was the third one.
Nice.
Yeah, and I thought, you know, this is cool. I really like this.
That is cool.
You know, the reason why the professor brought me in is he said, well, in this town, especially of Las Vegas, we see all these entertainers, and many people don't realize that they are brands.
Yes.
They're more than just a comedian, a magician. They are a brand with a team. And again, those product lines, and it was kind of an experiment for both parties, but it went really well. And of course, I entertain. That's always my default. I can make sure everybody's having a good time.
It's not even fair.
Pull people up. And
you don't
then,
like that? Let's do some juggling.
Yeah. The content was amped, but we had a great time. No, but it was just a great experience sitting and chatting with these EMBA students, and the questions that they asked were then forcing me to think about what I do from a different point of view. And they, of course, had the jargon, right? They were,
of course,
asking me about, you know, unique selling propositions and different ways of phrasing it that I hadn't really looked at. So it was
That's
really
cool.
Kind of a, yeah, it was a good experience all around. But my story, I guess you could say that I have a bit of a classic story. A lot of people who do something similar to what I do in the variety arts, you know, juggling, magic, you know, ventriloquism, comedy, they start very young. And, you know, you get into it for various reasons, whether it's attention-seeking or as like an icebreaker. I was the youngest of three boys.
Right.
And so looking back on it now, I absolutely think that played a big part of it. So there's Gene, John, and Jeff. I was called the caboose growing up. So it was kind of that situation where you're in school and they're going roll call and they say, oh, Civillico, I'll be expecting big things from you. Like, because of my brothers were, you know, very intelligent and just very successful guys.
Right.
And so everyone was kind of looking for me. So I think now when I look back on it, I think that was kind of something I just did to stand out. I became Jeff the Juggler. I had these like airbrushed t-shirts when I was 8 years old. I would wear the top hat and the confetti vest and the
I
had these like rainbow suspenders, and you know, I was just trying to find my voice, find a brand, and for the longest time I was Jeff the Juggler, but I loved that because that was my thing.
Yeah.
It was something that was uniquely mine.
Yes.
And it was my way of interacting with people.
That's so
and
cool.
Showtime with Jeff. So Yeah, so I always dreamed of having a Las Vegas show, even as a kid.
Right.
And I think that's
Can I interrupt you for
a minute? Yeah, please.
Where are you from, Jeff?
Philadelphia.
Philadelphia. Okay, yeah, so you're from Philly, you're growing up.
Yep, suburbs of Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Yeah, and now when I go back home to my parents' house, it's crazy. They still live there, and there was a deck outside, and there was a raised platform that was my stage. Yeah. And there was these kind of, you know, floodlights out there, and that was the spotlight.
Oh,
and I just remember, especially in the spring and summer, we all used to be grilling burgers out there, and Sundays, you know, and if neighbors would be around, and it was showtime with Jeff, and that was my first stage. And I remember going back there, you know, even 20 years later, and you're on that same stage, and it all comes back to you.
That's wild.
And there's still like a chest that I used to keep all my props.
Right.
Right. And some of those props are still there.
Wow.
Some of those really, you know.
That's very cool.
Yeah. So anyway, I think it's a testament to the power of the brand that Las Vegas has, because even as a kid, I wanted to have a show in Vegas. I didn't know what that meant.
Right.
I was 9, 10 years old, but I knew if I had a show in Vegas, like I made
it. You made it.
Right. So I think it's pretty incredible that the brand of Las Vegas is so powerful globally, but also mm-hmm. at that age, right? That you could be
that's incredible
doing little shows and realize
thinking
about the goal.
Vegas.
Yeah. So anyway, that was kind of, I think, you know, the genesis of all this and how I eventually came to Las Vegas. I was about 27, realized I wasn't getting any younger. If I'm gonna try
still
to have
in Philly,
a Vegas show,
still in Philly at this time.
So no, I went to college in D.C.
Okay.
I bounced around cruise ships. I actually bought a place in Orlando. And was living in Orlando, doing a lot of work with Disney, a lot of corporate work there. But I realized if I was going to make this, you know, Vegas thing happen, give it a run.
It's time to go.
So I literally packed up my car and drove out west 2010. And I never looked back.
That's incredible. So yeah. How old were you when you came out here?
So I got to do the math. Yeah, I was about 26, 27, I guess.
So you come out here 26, 27. Yeah. It's got to be just crazy. You're in Vegas. You're at the epicenter of your dream.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I know that it's difficult. And well, the reason I admire you so much is you came out here with nothing.
Yeah.
With no contacts.
I didn't know a single person.
And you made it happen. So I'm curious about that journey, about the adversity and the things that, you know, you had a hard time getting doors open.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
So I want to hear about that.
Yeah. You know what? I resonated with the energy of Las Vegas. Even when I remember driving, I literally drove my stuff out, and I remember getting here. I remember seeing, you know, that neon kind of charge in the desert. And I remember just being like, oh man, this is awesome. And even now, sometimes, you know, we all travel so much. You land somewhere and you're like, man, I want to take a nap. When I land in Vegas, I'm like, here we go. You know, like the energy is so powerful. And it's just, I feel like there's such a great entrepreneurial spirit here that's rooted in really the beginning of this, of how Vegas happened, right? And how Vegas keeps reinventing itself. And so, so I feel like when I got here, I knew like this was my spot. Because I was the same, the frequency was kind of same wavelength.
I like that.
Yeah, and so I didn't know a single person. Actually, the first person I connected with was Judy Morio.
No way!
Believe it or not. Yeah, as a fellow, of course, speaker and friend.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the reason why I connected with her was I had come from Orlando, and I was a part of the National Speaker Association chapter in Central Florida.
Right.
And they knew I was going to Vegas. Judy Morio was, I believe, the president or the incoming president of the chapter at the time, but of course, you know, legendary. Everybody knows Judy.
Yeah.
And so they said, oh, you got to connect with Judy. And I remember I called up the phone, called up Judy, right? And she's like, well, like, meet me at Mimi's Cafe tomorrow morning at like 7 a.m. for breakfast in Henderson. And I was like, okay. And so I literally just went over there and met her, and she was great. And she was actually the first person I connected with.
That's
crazy. I didn't think about that and place that until we all know and love her, of course.
Yeah. So those of us in Vegas, Judy, very well respected.
Yeah, legendary.
And she's been around for a long time. So that's really
authored
cool.
many books, you know, seminars, and
speaks all over the world.
She's amazing. But that's so funny.
That's
I didn't
so
even
cool.
place that. But
yeah,
you know, and I was kind of old school in my approach.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even know if this happens anymore, but I literally like knocked on doors, you know, and that means I just kind of like walked into entertainment offices and was like, hey, I'm Jeff, you know, giving business cards. And I went to every show that I possibly could.
Yep. Yep.
And I just literally introduced myself and said, hey, if you ever need a fill in or, you know, an
That's
opener.
Amazing,
and actually now I'm thinking about this. one of the next guys I met was Mike Rayburn.
No kidding.
Who was doing a show at Planet Hollywood at the time, the Amazed show, and I gave him a business card, and what's funny is he jokes about this now. He said, like, yeah, I remember this kid was real nice, outgoing, real energetic. I was like, man, who's this guy? He passed on the card to his manager at the time, and then he said he went off to do a bunch of corporate keynotes, and the next time he came back to Vegas, he said, that kid was in the show. And he was like, how did that happen? And we joke about that now, because he's like, I remember seeing this kid in the lobby, and then I went away for 3 days, because I got a call, you know, as it happens when someone needs you, right? The opportunity's there, and they needed a fill-in,
right?
And I had just given my card, and I was like, all right, why not? I'll throw this kid up there. So that was hilarious because now Mike talks about proactivity. I've heard him reference that to say this kid was literally handing out business cards, knocking on doors, and the next time I came back, he was in the show. Like, he was on stage. He was like, wait, is that the kid from the lobby?
It's the guy.
How did he get here?
The guy.
Like, I don't know. But it was pretty funny. But yeah, just hustling, kind of like old school hustling. In a good, I can have a negative.
In a good way. No,
but,
no.
Yeah, just putting in the effort and getting out there and meeting people. I used to go to. I remember now. I connected with Nathan Burton, who I ended up working with for several years as a guest act in his show. I met him at a party at Capo's, the Italian restaurant.
No kidding.
And I had kind of just heard that there was going to be a bunch of people at entertainers. I didn't know anybody, and I just showed up and like started mingling. I ended up connecting with him, and he ended up using me for like a couple years.
Yeah.
Kind of got me in with Caesars back in the day.
That's incredible.
So yeah, it was just old school, being proactive.
That's, you know, I'm talking to obviously my 1% Academy members here, you know, so we have people that are looking to start new businesses, they're looking to scale, they're looking to get into some new things, and obviously there's challenges, there's obstacles. You know, you come to Vegas knowing nobody at 27, and this is a very, very, how do you want to say it? It's a tight-knit group.
Yeah.
It's a small town.
Very small
town. So, like, everybody knows everybody once you're here, right?
Right.
So it's difficult to come in.
Yes.
So I guess, you know, for the entrepreneurs out there, because I see you as an entrepreneur, and you're going through the same steps as a business person would, attempting to create those connections. So I'm kind of getting off track here before you finish your story, but you're in this whole frame here. I'm looking for those keys to success, Jeff.
Yeah.
What were your,
action.
Action.
Action. I know everybody talks about that, but I just kind of dove in, and I meet and connect with so many entertainers now who are waiting for something to happen. And they're waiting to meet the right person, and they're waiting to go to the right event or get booked for the right event. And people say, like, well, how'd you get your show? They think that I auditioned for, like, the show spot, and that doesn't happen.
That doesn't
happen. They don't say, like, okay, we're having auditions for a 7 o'clock show, you know, and it's like, I got it, they picked me. I didn't do that, I just started performing. And I started taking action. I started doing a little. I'll go back to the story. It's a long, convoluted story. I started doing a dinner show at Planet Hollywood restaurant at the mall, and that was literally because I wanted to perform somewhere, and I wasn't going to wait for somebody to give me a legitimate spot somewhere.
Right.
So I made my own spot. So I went around and knocked on doors again, same thing, and talked to different restaurants and everything. And I thought, okay, maybe a restaurant show because people would be there anyway. Because I knew they weren't going to pay tickets to see me. You know, nobody knew who I was, right?
Right.
So I thought, okay, if they're eating anyway and I could come and entertain them, then that would be, you know, something good. And then there wouldn't be much overhead there because they would already be paying for dinner.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so, again, a guy took a chance on me at Planet Hollywood Restaurant, which is now Carmine's, in that footprint.
Yeah.
Upstairs, I built a stage. I bought a spotlight off of Craigslist. I Velcroed my iPad, my iPod, my Dino Pod, the big one, you know, like the giant one. It's like a Texas belt buckle.
I had it
like right here, and I would introduce him as my virtual sound man. And so, so I would come out and from the kitchen, and I would like be banging pots and pans, you know,
that's
make it
classic.
Seem like. And I'd come out and say, you know, I'd turn on the spotlight, and I'd drum roll, please, you know. And I sold my own merchandise and then packed
like
it all
up. You're like a street hustler in the restaurant.
Yeah.
I mean, you set it up. That's amazing.
Well, and then we started doing so well that we had to do actual tickets and, you know, with credit card machines and all that. And so I had to sell the tickets because I couldn't afford anyone to pay yet. So I was literally selling the tickets to my own dinner show and then selling the merchandise, packing it all up. So then I started doing Nathan Burton's show, and I was pushing them to my dinner show. So I would now, do his show.
Is he a magic guy or is he?
Yeah.
So Nathan Berthin, he's a magician here in Las Vegas.
Yeah, and at the time he was at the Flamingo at doing a 4 o'clock show. And so I actually was doing his show first. And I thought, okay, if I've got all these people here, I could push them to my show somewhere.
Right.
I didn't have a show yet, but I thought if I could push them somewhere, then that would be great marketing because I have built in, because he's paying for all the marketing to get people here, and then I'm just performing and can use all those people to push them to my show.
Bingo.
And so I remember I struck a deal with Nathan. I said, hey, would you mind if I pushed people to my show, after your show? And he's like, well, you don't have a show. I'm like, I know, but theoretically, like, I'll get a show somewhere. If I got a show somewhere, do you mind if I push him? He's like, no, that's fine. And so that's what happened is I got this show knowing that I had a built-in marketing platform of a bigger show. So anyway, the point of this is that I meet a lot of people and entertainers and they say, you know, I wish, you know, how'd you get your show? I knew the right people.
Wow, you got some good breaks. You know, I mean, and that's what I wanted people to hear, is because it's all about, for you, if you came here with an idea and a goal and you're waiting for stuff to happen, you're still going to be waiting.
Right.
But now you've positioned yourself as an iconic Las Vegas entertainer because you took action.
Yeah. Hey, you know, just the other night, here's a great example of some of people who are doing it right and kind of actions that I would encourage. There were a couple magicians put on a show, and they wanted to do a showcase.
Right.
And so they, it was Mateo and Christian, is the other guy's name. Mateo was Chris Angel's assistant for many years.
Okay.
And Chris Angel, when he moved to Planet Hollywood in the new show, he didn't have that Mateo role. So he kind of wanted to do his own thing, partnered up with someone. And again, instead of waiting, they said, hey, let's do a showcase for the Vegas community. They got a theater, and they said, we'll donate all the money to Win-Win. That's not the point. We're not trying to make money off this. We're just trying to bring the community in. So they said, they picked us. They've done hospital visits for us. And so they thought, okay, let's do this. But the point is, like, they made it happen. You know, they got a theater, and they figured they produced the show. They made it a charity event. So they did the proceeds. I don't know who they got in that room, and you know, whether they're videotaping and what their goals are, but my point is they're not sitting around waiting. So hey, you know what, like, let's put together a showcase, let's invite the friends, the community,
right?
And so I applaud that. Like, I see people doing that, and I'm like, well, that's how you do it, not sit around and wait for somebody.
All right, so action.
Yeah,
what else? I asked Jeff for his three keys to success prior to coming on, so we could kind of think about that, because every entrepreneur has a different focus on what was the keys to get them to where they are today. So Jeff, what do you think?
Yeah, well, action, I think infused with so much passion that it's contagious, that you people want to help you.
Yeah.
And again, getting back to money, I think money is a really easy out for people. They say, like, I don't have the money, so I can't do this. I always want to say, like, money is the last piece. Like, get everything else and the money will come. And so, like, Kickstarter, you see this all the time.
Right.
If somebody says, like, oh, I want, you know, $20,000 and I'm gonna build this cool, innovative technology or this cool thing, people are like, okay, whatever, right? But if they say, here are the plans, here are the blueprints, here are the designs, here's how we're going to monetize it, here's how we're going to scale it, you know, I need this much money exactly, it's going to go to this, and that's going to enable us to do this,
right?
Then all of a sudden people are like, oh, yeah, I'll give you 10 bucks, I'll give you 20 bucks. A corporate sponsor will say, oh, you know what, I see the vision.
I see it.
So I think it's not just kind of empty action, it's action that's backed with so much kind of passion and that's contagious, that people want to help you, they want to jump on board.
Right, but there's strategy there too, because like you said, you're bringing a game plan to the table.
Exactly.
I mean, you have passion for what you do.
Exactly.
But you also have a,
exactly,
here's what it's going to look like, here's
another real life example. Okay, I hosted FedEx offices incentive trip in Portugal, which was an amazing,
nice.
Sometimes you go to Watford City, North Dakota, sometimes you go to Portugal.
I know that.
Take the good ones, the bad ones. No offense to all my my homies in Watford City, my fans. But really, I did this awesome gig at the in FedEx office, and I'm flying back with the CEO, who could not have been nicer. He and his wife, and we were talking all about Win-Win, my charity, this and that. And he's like, "I want to help out. I want to get involved." So now Win-Win Entertainment has a partnership with FedEx Office, where they're going to print and deliver flyers to all of our programs all over the country.
Wow.
So that's pretty incredible. They're not just printing, but they're also, you know, they're going to the labor to deliver those flyers.
Nice.
So, and that might not seem like much, a flyer for how does that work, but think about, if you're in a hospital room and there's a professional entertainer who's going to be coming on Thursday, and you get a flyer under your door on Monday, you can connect with that performer, yeah. build a relationship, yeah. follow them on social media. Now, when that person walks in their door, that's a life-changing experience.
Different
that's
experience.
Totally different than somebody's knocking right at a cold intro. So that was incredible, and I couldn't believe that he and they were willing to do that.
Right.
But if you think about it, that was the last step, right? The network was already there. All
yes.
the entertainers were there. So if I just randomly said to FedEx, hey, I've got this idea. I want to create a nonprofit that sends performers to hospitals. They'd be like, okay, like, that sounds cool, but like, what do you want from us? Like, they're not gonna be like, write a check here. Or like, that sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
So again, the money, the in-kind sponsorship, that donation was the last step after the network and all the work. And they could go to the website and see they've been around for you know 10 years. They have a board of directors with established people. It's a credible organization.
Yep.
So, and I'm kind of pivoting to the nonprofit,
yep.
but the point is the same. It's that action, right?
Action.
I didn't wait for the FedEx. So obviously that makes it a lot easier now, and
yeah.
that makes it easier. We're talking to some other companies now about doing some ride share to bring performers to the hospital.
Oh, nice.
Right, which would be
That's
great.
Huge. Yeah.
yeah, but again, that wouldn't have happened without that action and without so much passion behind it.
Yeah.
So again, I think, you know, talk about action as a key step, that passion. Don't let money be the roadblock, because it's such an easy roadblock.
It's an easy
it's
roadblock.
It's so easy.
Right?
People just be like, oh, that guy's got a ton of money. That girl comes
yeah.
from money. I'm not gonna, you know, I'm not like that, right?
Right.
That's the last piece. And oftentimes too, you can barter. I've done so much with bartering, like old school bartering, you know? Seriously, we think
yeah.
about, you know, I've done so many free shows in exchange for services, in exchange
yeah.
for other things. It just, that blows my mind how people say, oh, I can't afford, like, you know, I can't afford a new headshot. Okay, so, you know, and you're a social media person. So maybe you say, you know what, I'm gonna say I'd like a free headshot or a free comp card or something in
right.
exchange for I'm gonna do social media for you, this, or
That's
I'm gonna
right.
give you a free, you know, 2-hour coaching.
That's it.
Right? People don't
there's
think like that, though.
Right.
Yeah, there's always a way
if you
think about that.
Yeah, yeah. So before we get into win-win,
which is
Jeff's charity, I'm just trying to get these bullet points here. So
yeah.
you got the action step, you got the passion.
Yeah.
What would be your third key to success?
I would say the vision. Just to kind of have the vision of where it's all going. I think reflection is so important.
Yeah.
I think especially today with everyone is so busy and everyone's going a mile a minute. Every calendar's packed. If you don't take the time to stop and reflect and think about where you are and where you're going and if you're enjoying the work that you're doing and if that's making a difference, you can always change direction. You can
yeah.
always pivot. I love that word pivot. I talk about that
yeah.
a lot because sometimes just that small pivot is all you need.
Yeah.
Right? The difference between maybe it's the same product, but instead of doing it for this market, you kind of shift it and
right.
you realize, oh man, I really resonate more here.
Right.
And this makes me feel more fulfilled. And you know, so I don't know. I think that's a big one too, is reflecting and seeing where you are. I'm always very aware of, you know, overall, like my age, how long I've been doing this, where I want to be in a few years, where I was a couple years ago. I'm aware of the day of the week, the quarter, like, hey, we're closing up Q1.
Mm-hmm.
I'm thinking about like how Q1 went
right
now and how Q2 I'm going to change and improve things.
Yeah.
You know, I'm looking at health. I'm looking at finances. I'm looking at relationships. I'm looking at all aspects of my life and saying, okay, this is going well. Yeah, I got to double down here or keep going here. But this, I really let this slide, so this is going to be a new focus. Because I think so many times in Vegas, especially in the entertainment world, it's such a bubble.
Wow, yeah.
You can blink and realize you've been on the strip for 10 years. That's what happened to me. I was on the 6 nights a week for 6 years.
Wow.
And then I had to actually stop and say, I love Vegas and I love having a show here, but there's so much more I want to do.
Yeah. But like you said, it's a great platform.
It's a great platform.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's just important for people, instead of just head down and powering through, I think it's important to periodically stop and really assess, turn off your devices, turn off notifications, like go over a hike, you know, go get out and just kind of think about how it's going in a bigger picture sense.
I hear that a lot, and I gotta, you know, I gotta be honest, is like, I wasn't very good at that. You know, I wasn't very good at that. I was go, thinking about, never really thinking about accomplishments, just what's on the horizon next.
Yeah.
And so then I got diagnosed with amyloidosis, and my life changed completely, and it's made a big difference, just being able to take a look at your life and really enjoy it.
Yeah.
And what am I actually doing? And what am I doing it for? who's the benefactor, or, you know, and really thinking about things.
What's the point, right? Where's it all going?
I never thought about those things until my life was in front of my eyes, because I was just doing.
Right. Yeah, I think a lot of people talk about living on purpose, you know, or, you know, with kind of direction, and that's, I think, spot on. I think we all can fall victim to it.
It's human nature.
Yeah,
it's human nature. It really is. So it's great that you do that, and I see what's unique with you. From other entertainers that I've met, is you actually are thinking about things like, I'm finishing up my Q1, and so what's going on? And those conversations I don't hear from entertainers, and it's not a good thing or a bad thing. It's just how you're put together as a human being,
right?
You know,
yeah. And you talk about, like, you know, doing things that matter and reflecting. For me, I was 6 years on the Strip, and then I realized, hey, I love doing this. This is great. But at the end of the day, I really love connecting with people.
Yeah.
We're on stage and off. Like, I'm that guy who talks to you on a flight, or I talk to my Uber driver. You know, a lot of people don't like guys like me. They just want to, like, tune out. But I love connecting with people, whether it's just, you know, the casual person at a conference or on stage. And so I realized, if now I've got this nonprofit, if I can focus on this, that's going to have such a greater impact.
Yeah.
Long term, that can live way beyond me. I come and go. This could be something that lives on to really move the needle and do something good. I think that's important. You don't really think about that unless you stop and reflect. So it's all related.
It is related.
Yeah.
So thank you for that. So Jeff, I want to talk to you. I want to talk about your charity, the Win-Win Organization.
Yes.
And so Jeff is, you know, the new Mr. Las Vegas here. And he's created this incredible charity where he goes into hospitals, and you can tell more about it, with entertainers, and literally brightens up their day and gives them something to think about. And the entertainers get a sense of purpose because they get out and they get to give back. And tell us about that.
Yeah, I mean, it's called Win-Win Entertainment, and you hit the nail on the head. You're talking about, you know, the entertainers get to give back, and that is the win for them. A lot of entertainers, we are naturally, you know, no fault of our own, like, we have to be very shameless with our self-promotion.
Right? Yes,
we have to be putting butts in seats, right? Booking dates, booking shows. You're always marketing product, you know, me, right?
Yes.
And so the Win-Win shows really kind of touch a different part of an entertainer's heart, their head and heart.
Right.
It activates a part that they might not have had touched it in a while, and it really makes them feel good, and it makes them want to give back more. So the win on the charity side, of course, is fairly obvious, right?
Yeah.
They're getting high quality talent. So, you know, Win-Win at the end of the day is simply a philanthropic network for professional entertainers to plug themselves into.
That's awesome.
We do focus on youth in need. Children's hospitals, definitely kind of our flagship program.
Yeah.
But we also do a lot with foster homes, like St. Jude's Ranch, Children, Ronald McDonald House, mentoring with Core Academy, programs like that. We do a lot of special needs, work with Miracle League and Special Olympics and Title I schools as well.
That's awesome.
And it all kind of grew very organically.
Yeah. The more we
post, the more people want to get involved.
Yeah.
We just launched in New York in February, and again, I didn't really know how that was going to go because we have so many entertainers here.
Right.
Right, but in New York, you know, there's a lot of talent there.
Oh, boy.
I don't know them.
Right, you're not connected to them.
I'm not connected as much, right? And so, but we started, I did a show there February to kind of kick things off, and then all of a sudden, David Goldrake, who was a headliner here at the Tropicana for many years, phenomenal magician, he said, hey, I'm going to be in New York, you know, I'd love to help out. So he jumped in, and now we've got April and May booked. And
wow.
So now it's exciting.
That's really cool. So the quick kind of synopsis on this is, so there's so many entertainers in Las Vegas, which is absolutely amazing, from people doing card tricks to people who are dancers or jugglers or all types of stuff. So they contract with Win-Win. They go in to, it could be an 11-year-old person with leukemia who the best thing in their life in the last week is that somebody comes in and does these card tricks for them.
Yeah.
I mean, it's incredible.
The
level of talent that goes into these hospitals, and it's just amazing.
Thanks. Yeah, it's crazy. It kind of expanded way beyond what I could ever even think of.
Right.
I mean, in my head, there was kind of it was guys like me, right? You know, jugglers, magicians, things like that. But now we worked NFL alumni They come visit.
Okay.
Yeah, like the Miss Nevada organization, Miss Teen Nevada, they're now contacting us to you know, set up hospital visits and and it's everything from, I mean, headliners to like stilt walkers to costume characters to everybody wants to get involved. Mm-hmm. You know who's just getting involved is Bark Andre Ferry. So Bark, do you know Bark?
No, I don't.
He's like the unofficial mascot for the Golden Knights. Be careful.
The guy?
No, the dog. The, oh. Yeah, no, it's a, yeah. So there's Mark Andre for the goalie.
No, I know.
But there's Bark is the doggy.
I thought I misunderstood you because there's this guy at the Knights game who Wolverine.
Oh yeah, the Wolverine. I know him actually. He's a friend. Yeah. His wife works with Caesars. Yeah, no, BGK Wolverine man. No, that's hilarious. But man, maybe we can get him and Bark to team up
with Heather.
But you know, so my point is that once you get things going and set things in motion, and if the vision is there and the action, the passion, it can grow well beyond what you were ever intending in the best possible way. So when I think about, you know, what Win-Win has become, it was kind of people like me in Las Vegas. Now it's, you know, we're in seven cities. We're in Orlando, Reno, Minneapolis, New York, etc.
Wow.
And now when I think about who's coming to perform, I'm like, we got, you know, NFL players visiting, kids signing autographs. We've got, you know, Miss Nevada is coming by. Like all these people who are now getting involved that I had no concept of that in the beginning. So just shows you things can get out of hand in a very good way.
Right. You know? Well, that's great. You created a platform where people can go give back, and they're doing that.
Exactly.
And that shows that people do really want to give back. Sometimes they just don't know how.
They don't know how, and everyone's distracted. Everyone has their own lives going on. And so our mantra is we remove the obstacles and make it easy to give back.
That's awesome.
That's what we try to do.
I like that. So, Jeff, I want to tell us what you're doing now. Where can people go see you if they want to see you perform? And then, of course, where we can find you. So
yeah, I got a show in 8 hours here today. Of course, Wednesday night in Las Vegas.
Okay.
So
where's that show?
It's at the Paris.
Okay.
So the Paris, you know, Center Strip, great property, really fun venue. It's about 225 seat venue, so it's nice. Intimate, it's like a cabaret style. And so I'm there every Wednesday night.
Okay.
So that's by far the easiest way to see me. I do a lot of, just like you, a lot of private corporate events, speaking and hosting and other things as well.
Do some MC work, always, I see, too.
Yeah, you know, it's funny, because I've done some TV hosting, and then I do all these live events, and so I found a really nice niche as a conference MC.
Yes.
It's a multi-day conference MC.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm doing that more and more now.
And that's a very that's a specialized gig here, especially in Las Vegas or any city that has a big type of corporate events where they'll have like evening dinner type of things, and awards, and Jeff is just, he's such a professional, and what's amazing about it is he can do the MC work, and he's a great speaker, but he's also an entertainer, which is just unbelievable.
Thank you. I really like it because you get positioned in a different way, because when you're the entertainer, the show, the big banquet show, and you know, Four Seasons, but it's like tonight's entertainer has won Best of Las Vegas. It's like, well, you know, okay, let's see what you got, kid. It's like, you know, I always joke, say, juggle for me, monkey. You know, it's like, dance for me. Like, let's see. And unfortunately, the way that people are, they almost are like, oh, actually, it was really good. Actually, it was better than, than I thought. Everyone kind of almost assumes or wants to assume, like, the entertainment isn't going to be that good, which is frustrating in and of itself, right? But so as I'm positioned there, it's very hard to win over those corporate audiences. But when you're the MC, you have 3, 4, 5 days, and they don't see it coming. So then you just seem like this very talented MC.
Articulate guy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Because they say, hey, we brought this guy. We've heard our meetings of, you know, are a little on the dry side, or, you know, we want to make our meeting a little more unique or more fun, or we're in Vegas, or we're in New Orleans. Or we thought we'd have a little fun here, so we brought in this guy to MC. He's going to have some fun with us. It's more general. It's like he's going to keep things moving, keep us engaged, and have some fun along the way. So then when you bust out some of your
skills,
act, they're like, wait, whoa! Like, they have no idea. They don't see it coming. And so, I kind of like that positioning better because, I think you have a stronger impact.
Yeah.
And then you can do all their social media videos as well as their conference recap videos. So you get to flex the onstage muscles, the hosting, but then you also get to flex the on-camera work, which is a different skill. So those, to me, are my favorite types of events right now.
I can see that.
I did Sprint their national sales summit in January, Endo Pharmaceuticals in February. I'm doing Spring Hill Suites next month, and NutriBlend, and I don't know, I'm booking a lot of them these days, and there's not too many people in the space. Maybe I shouldn't have announced it.
No, that's good. Wow. You still got to bring the talent.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, there's a million people that want to be speakers that put up a website that don't know how to speak. So, you know, I'm not worried about So, that's exciting. So, where can people find you on social media?
JeffCivillico.com and at JeffCivillico on all social media platforms. And winwinentertainment.org is the website there. And Win-Win Charity is our social media on everything. So
right, Win is just W-I-N.
W-I-N.
So yeah, Jeff is a superstar. Check out his website, go to YouTube, do a little search. He's got all types of shows and interviews, and he is a Las Vegas icon. So I'm thrilled that he's able to spend some time with us today and expose our 1% Academy to Jeff. And what I think you'll see is that no matter what you're looking to do, it all comes down to certain types of behaviors that separate top people from those who struggle, whether you're an entertainer, or you're an entertainer slash business person, or you're an entrepreneur. You know, Jeff talks about action, passion. What was the third one, Jeff?
Vision.
Having a vision of where you're going to go. And I think that's helped you a lot, because it seems to me, not knowing you that well, is that you're also a guy that when you come to the table, you have your ducks in a row.
Yeah.
So you're not just someone with some kind of a dream. There's things behind it. Like you
strategy. Well, you mentioned strategy. Yeah, like vision with a strategy.
Yeah.
Can I throw in one more thing?
Please.
So when you talk about all those things, you're going to hit problems. You're going to hit challenges. And I think how you react to and respond to those challenges is very important.
Yep.
I definitely have had, we always joke like high highs and low lows within entertainment. You're only as good as your last show. Sometimes you're just killing it. Everything's going great. And then all of a sudden, you just feel like, man, I wish I was doing better, or you look at this person or that person, which is always a mistake, right? to compare yourself, because everybody's on their own journey, and you realize, you think like, man, I haven't gotten an inquiry in a few days, like maybe I had a good run, and then all of a sudden like you book four events, in this course of 2 hours. It's a weird business.
Right, it is a weird business.
But yeah, everybody has those challenges, and I think it's really important to just keep moving forward. I always just think, even if I'm really fried mentally, I'm not there, I'll just do something to keep things moving forward. Whether it's even something as simple as straightening my desk, or going to walk on the treadmill and call a friend, check in with another entertainer, or just say hi. Just kind of, if I'm too kind of fried to really do the tough mental work, or write or compose an actual coherent thought in an email, but I still want to just kind of be doing something. I'll read some articles, or read some things on LinkedIn, or just kind of keep things moving forward. Just knowing that there's going to be better days than others, but you can't stop moving forward. Can't stop taking that action.
That's awesome. That's great advice. So I want to go a little deeper with you, if you're okay.
Yeah.
So I'm the psychology kind of deep thinking guy. So you're talking about, and things aren't going so well. You just got to, you got to fight through it and push through. So that's great, right? So a lot of people, one of my pet peeves these days is people that get on Instagram or whatever, and they say, you just got to fight through it.
You got to be tough.
So, and I don't mean that directed at you, but the point is that some people don't know how to do that, Jeff. So everybody's different. So when you say, you got to fight through it, you got to take action. How do you do it? How do you do it?
So I think when I say keep things moving forward, I mean having, I think, again, say it's all related. I think taking that step back and being able to reflect and realize that what might appear as a big failure is actually not. You're still trending upward. You're still kind of going in the right direction. You just had a minor setback, or you had a lesson that you needed to learn to propel you to that next level. So some things that obviously are come off immediately as a failure are really the best thing that ever happened to you.
Right.
I love Conan O'Brien. I listen to his podcast all the time, and he talks with all these people, and they say, looking back on it, thank God Conan didn't get that dream job he wanted, which was to be a writer for Letterman, because if he had done that, then XYZ would have happened. He wouldn't be Conan O'Brien, right?
That's true.
And so, and that comes up all the time when he's talking with comedians and actors and actresses. It's that thing, I really want this role, I really want this role. Well, guess what? That show was canceled in, you know,
right.
two episodes, and then you booked Friends. You know, like right. there's all these different. So I think it's important to just again take a step back and realize that it's a much longer journey.
Yes.
That you have a much when you have more time to reflect and to zoom out a little bit. Mm-hmm. So when I say keep things moving forward, it might literally be like, hey, I'm not having a good day, but I've been going hard, traveling a lot. Like, take that as a sign. I need to take the rest of the day off. Like, that could be what you need to do to keep things moving forward. Because in a longer term picture, you got to take care of yourself, your health, your mentality. And so that's what I mean when I say fight through it. I mean mentally.
Yep.
Not, you know, just.
Yeah, I get it.
Yeah, it's like just know, kind of listen to yourself. Listen to your body, listen to how you're feeling, and know, hey, maybe this is a sign that I need to just chill out and I need to have a night with friends. I need mm-hmm. to, you know, go on that hike. Yep. I need to just kind of relax a little bit. Yeah.
So it leads me to your underlying belief about who you are, because that's what's driving you.
Yeah.
And so my question is where do you see yourself in 5 years?
Oof.
Mr. Las Vegas.
Oh man. Well, so I don't always know where I'm going, right? I know where I want to go, but I know what makes me feel alive, okay. and what makes me feel very connected to a sense of purpose,
right.
and a bigger picture, bigger meaning. And for me, that really is the nonprofit. And so when you talk about where we're going to be in 5 years, I would love Win-Win Entertainment to be in every major city in the country. I'd love to have some in-hospital room programming that's specific for content in hospitals that can to kind of amplify the way that we resonate. So we have performers who do in-person visits, of course, but there's a lot of markets. You know, they're going to be able to get a performer to Grand Rapids, you know, Michigan necessarily, but they all have in-room programming.
Right.
So I'd love that kind of idea of supplementing with that. I want to just keep growing my business. I feel like I've kind of gotten a really handle on who I am in the last kind of couple of years.
Yeah.
So I would love to settle down. I want to be a dad. I'd love to be a great husband and a great father. So, you know, on the personal side of things as well, sometimes it's hard with all the travel, definitely. As you know. And so I am kind of trying to taper down on the travel.
Yeah.
In the hope of getting some sort of a personal life back.
Well, we do have millions of viewers, Jeff. So are you single?
Yes, single.
Yeah. Good Lord.
Man, now you're making me blush.
That's all good.
But yeah, I mean, really, it's hard because you want to be home. But at the same time, right now, being a single guy, it's hard to turn down those events, those offers, those jobs. But you realize you don't always want to be doing that. Right. So you kind of have to start tapering down to create more of a balanced lifestyle. So I do believe that, you know, it's not healthy to be on the road, 250 days a year.
Definitely
right.
Not.
So,
definitely.
Yeah. So I'm trying to find that balance right now and trying to work through what's going to make me the happiest. Yeah.
Well, you're a young guy, you're just in your prime right now, just approaching your prime, so you're on the right track. And, you know, I brought that up, you know, because all the 1% Academy members that are watching this, you know, Jeff is extremely successful, sharp guy, articulate. What's driving Jeff, though, is his belief system. Mm-hmm. He has a belief about himself that allows him to take action and move forward, and I don't know this, but he might see himself as Mr. Las Vegas. But the point is, he has a vision for himself, and it's a certainty that he has, and he's developed that belief system. So, you know, when I talk to people about taking that next step, it really starts in their mindset, Jeff, you know?
Yeah.
You're not able to take action, you're not able to follow your dreams if you don't really believe in you and your talents and skills. So,
right.
So many people have a difficult time with, you know, the self-doubt and the disempowering beliefs that keep holding them back in their life. Like, you know, if you're waiting for that sign to show up for you to move to Las Vegas and do your thing, it's never going to happen.
Right.
But like you said, you saw it, you did it, you moved forward because you had a belief in yourself that was what your future was.
Yeah.
So I think that's one of the things that I really, you know, we can talk about strategy and X's and O's, but it starts with your mindset.
Yeah. No, you're 100% right.
Yeah. So
I love it.
Thank you so much for being a part of our 1% family.
Yeah.
So Jeff Civillico, Mr. Las Vegas, 2019. Come to Vegas, see his show at the Paris.
Yep.
Win-Win Entertainment, where he's touching people's lives on a daily basis with young people all over the country who are going through tough times. And so Jeff, thank you so much. It's been an honor.
and a privilege. You're a good dude.
Thank you very much. And, right back at you.
Hopefully we can hang out sometime.
I'd love it.
See you later from Las Vegas.
Bye bye.
All right,
cool.
Good job, man.
Is that okay? Okay, awesome.
That was awesome.
Yeah, that felt, I can't believe, was that like an hour?
Oh my God, yeah, that was easy, but I knew it would be easy. You're great on camera.
I appreciate the heads up. This is really fun. I do it like it's nothing. There's times where I might blow like 50k on a vacation for all my soldiers just to see the looks on all their faces. All it took was patience. I got a lot of friends to come up off the strip for me. The same ones that'll come up off the hip for me.